Mike Mullen is with Ross Camp Institute and the executive director, and I very much have been looking forward to what he's going to share with us today. Just a little bit of background about Dr. Mullen. He received his MD from London University in 1985. 8 years later, in 1993, Dr. Mullen received his PhD in molecular genetics from London University. And after he studied with families that multiply are affected by Alzheimer's disease, beginning when people were only 50 years old. Dr. Mullen is one of the co-discoverers of the first genetic mutations causing Alzheimer's disease in rare and early onset families. These mutations are used by hundreds of laboratories around the world every day to model and find treatments for Alzheimer's disease. He's authored and co-authored over 250 papers in scientific journals, as well as written multiple chapters in various books. Along with my father, Bob, and his wife, Diane Roskamp, he and Dr. Fiona Crawford co-founded the Roskamp Institute in 1998. He is now the executive director of the Ross Camp Institute, which moved to Sarasota in 2003. The Institute has generated multiple new leads to treat Alzheimer's disease and related disorders. Most recently, the work emanating from the Institute has led to a phase 3 trial of a new drug approach to treat Alzheimer's. This trial is just concluded in Europe. Dr. Mullen.
Thanks, Steve, and lovely to see you all this afternoon. I know there's some very smart people in the audience because I know some of you. So I'm going to invite you to ask questions as we go along, but I will leave space at the end for plenty of time, I think, for questioning. Today, I really want to update you on where we are in the world of Alzheimer's research. We shouldn't think of this as a sort of an esoteric pastime of researchers, because where we are in the world of Alzheimer's research is kind of where we are socially with dealing with what I think is accurate to call an epidemic of Alzheimer's disease, both in this country and around the world. And I've called the talk Alzheimer's Disease Research at a Crossroads, because in view of some very critical recent data from large pharmaceutical companies looking at what were promising treatments for Alzheimer's disease, we really have come to an important decision point. And when I say we, I mean the academic community, the pharmaceutical community, and it extends far beyond that. It extends also to the sort of the political realm as well, about how we're going to deal with this disorder. We've come to kind of a critical point of where to go from here, because we've run into some pretty hard brick walls lately, collectively, unfortunately. And so really the focus of my talk today is, you know, what is the nature of those challenges, and where do we go from here? How do we overcome them? What's the path forward? So the goals of this presentation is really to introduce you to what's known as the amyloid cascade hypothesis, the ACH, amyloid cascade hypothesis. I really want to give you an understanding of what that is and a little bit of the history, and a summary of what the recent trials have been and what the previous ones have been, looking at the ACH and looking at amyloid as a target, the main target for Alzheimer's disease. I want to talk a little bit about the reasons for failures, why those studies really haven't worked, and what the implications of that is, and what should we focus on, and I've also said defocus, because I think there's a very strong argument here that we have to move away from this amyloid-centric view of Alzheimer's disease, because once the disease is established, going after amyloid just isn't working. And that's one of the take-home messages here. And meanwhile, what can we do to reduce our risk for Alzheimer's disease? You know, I don't like the idea, and I'm sure you don't either, of kind of sitting on our hands, waiting for the research to move forward. I mean, I'm deep in the research every day and spend a lot of my time tapping my fingers waiting for the next results from the lab. I mean, it's a long and arduous process. And is there anything we can do? Are there things we can do to protect ourselves against Alzheimer's disease before there are drug treatments? I'm going to talk about that. So, you know, these are some of the frightening statistics. I mean, there's lots of ways to look at who's got the disease already, who's at risk, and so on. But whichever way you look at it, the numbers are frightening. So there's probably about 5.5 million people in this country alone that have Alzheimer's disease already. Maybe as many as 1 in 9 people over the age of 65 that have the disease. And of course, it's not just America that's affected, it's the rest of the world too, and there are probably another 45 or so million people worldwide that all already have the disease. And it's not so much the numbers, but the ways in which those numbers are increasing. It's not linear, it's exponential. The curve looks like that. So by the time we get to 2050, some of these estimates suggest that those numbers will all double. And it goes without saying, and it's difficult not to be touched some way in life by somebody that has the disease, you know, a relative or a friend, a family member of somebody you know. And so, you know, when we talk about the financial costs, the emotional costs, the cost to society in various ways, the numbers are just stunning. And I can't actually. I don't really know what $250 billion looks like or feels like, but it's an awful lot of money, and you can compare it with other things. And it's getting worse. That's the problem. You know, that if you look at caregivers of folks with Alzheimer's disease, the time they take off work, the mental illness they suffer, the physical illnesses they suffer, the cost to themselves personally. We all know this story. That's why we're here, to work on it. So this was an article that some of you may have read recently in the Herald Tribune. And, you know, this is Barbara Peter-Smith that's taken this position. Decades down a path littered with more than 100 failed experimental drugs for Alzheimer's disease, a growing chorus of scientists is saying it's time to admit defeat and start afresh. I would take the admit defeat part out because I really want to put the anti-amyloid approaches in place. But start afresh, broaden our horizons, definitely. So, you know, should we be looking at different aspects of the disease? Should we be looking at different ways to treat the disease, particularly when it's established? So, you know, what's the amyloid cascade hypothesis? So we have billions, tens of billions of neurons in our brain, and that's what you're using to listen to me with right now and understand what I'm saying. And normally, there's no other sort of amorphous, fibrous material around that's causing any problems. Even though we all make amyloid all the time, you're all making amyloid in your brains right now, and so am I, and we've done it since 9 months before we were born. We were making it, you make it very early on, nice, but it doesn't cause us any problems. We clear it. It's produced in the brain, but it's cleared. But later on, it accumulates for whatever reason, and we can talk about that. It accumulates in these things called plaques. They're actually spherical, but when you look at autopsy samples of Alzheimer's brain, you know, they look like circular things because we're slicing. But there's spheres that occur in and around the neurons, and downstream of that observation, so we can see this really quite early, and then downstream of that, what happens is the neurons, instead of going from these lovely branch structures which connect with other neurons, they become very dystrophic, and they accumulate this stuff inside them, which is another protein called tau, and they accumulate these things called tangles. So that happens next, and then the neurons die. And when the neurons start dying, particularly when they die en masse, that's when we start to get the clinical features. And I'll talk a lot more about that and what that means as I move forward here. So As I said, these are neurons. There's one neuron with it, a long process called an axon, but this branching structure around here is where it receives information from all these other neurons. I mean, these things make computer circuits look like something out of play school, because some of these neurons connect with thousands of other neurons, and to coordinate signals in the brain, and really, this is the sort of biological underpinnings of our thinking and our memories and so on. So what happens, this is a normal brain, but what happens in time is that we get these accumulations of this protein called amyloid, and they accumulate in these clumps, these insoluble clumps in and around between neurons. And this can happen many years, decades, perhaps as many as two decades before there are any clinical signs or symptoms at all. So it's very safe to say that not only are there people driving around with amyloid in their brains, there's plenty of those, they're probably flying airplanes and, you know, in charge of nuclear power stations and a whole load of other things too. Why? Because there's no clinical symptoms, there's no signs. It doesn't impact our thinking, doesn't impact our cognition at all. So this happens very early. And then over time, it, you know, more and more of it builds up. And so those things, as I've said, are called plaques. And then downstream of that, we start to see something different. We start to see that accumulation of tangles and tau. So what's that about? Well, inside a normal neuron, you have these railway lines. These are molecular railway lines, and they're responsible for moving chemicals up and down the neuron. They move from the end of the neuron back again, they move different chemicals down, so they have these cargos that are carried up and down. Very, very important for neurons to function properly, to get the sort of chemicals they need to the end of the neuron, to be able to contact other neurons. And what happens is, and importantly, a part of that, you know, like the sleepers that you have under a real railway track, tau is the kind of a support system for the railways. And what happens is tau, instead of kind of sticking to the railway track, after a while starts to stick to itself. So you get it kind of breaks off, and it finally forms these things called tangles. And that's what you see inside the neuron. But by that time, this whole function down here of moving things down to the end of the neuron, that's all lost. It's gone. So tau and tangle formation in particular correlates much better with memory loss and cognitive problems, as does amyloid accumulation. So that's a very important thing to think about as we move forward here and we talk about potential other targets in the disease. So, you know, that happens at a sort of a crossover point between being cognitively normal, which is what you are when you have all this amyloid, and moving into the realm of mild cognitive impairment, which is where you just have one thing wrong, usually memory, but it doesn't impact your activities of daily living, it doesn't impact social things and so on. But memory impairment is usually the first thing, and so MCI is this very early stage. And we can see these tau phenomenon beginning to happen prior to that, and then actually during that early stage. And then as that all moves forward, particularly with the neuronal loss here, as that moves forward, we start to see death and loss of neurons. And at that point, the brain, because the brain's primarily consists of neurons, as the neurons die, the brain shrinks. And so you can see that on MRI. And this would be a typical advanced Alzheimer brain, and particularly this area here, which is called the hippocampus, which is where all our immediate memory comes from and requires this part of the brain, that disappears. And that's why Alzheimer's starts with loss of information for recently presented information, because that's where that's all handled, down here in the hippocampus. But you can see this is the volume of tissue here is greatly diminished compared to a normal brain. So once that starts happening, we have full-blown dementia. And then as that progresses, as the loss of brain structure, you know, increases, then we get into more and more profound dementia. And then, of course, we all know how you know, that story ends. And so, you know, right down here, this is where we have kind of full-blown dementia with increased clinical symptoms. So what are the consequences of us having really focused? So if you think about the last slide I just showed you, we've really only focused most of our funding and most of our energies on the first part of that story, the amyloid part, right at the beginning. And the theory was that if you lower amyloid, then you could slow or cure Alzheimer's disease. Because you can see from that that the amyloid seems to be very associated with very early stages of the disease. So the pharmaceutical industry, NIH, most of the big funding agencies have really put most of the effort, most of the funding, billions and billions of dollars into going after amyloid. And here's the problem, that once the disease is established, so that there's moderate or severe disease or even late stage mild disease, these drugs are just not working. Taking amyloid away at that point isn't working. There actually was a very interesting study done using a vaccine. So what they did, they injected some amyloid under the skin of folks that had mild to moderate Alzheimer's disease. And the body raises antibodies against amyloid. The antibodies find their way into the brain. The antibodies, with the help of other cells, remove the amyloid from the brain. And so what happened with these folks, that when they were followed up over a long period of time, and they went to the brain, their brains went to autopsy, and when they looked in the brains, there was no amyloid. The amyloid was gone, and so was most of the tau as well. But the problem was that even though the amyloid had been taken away, they just kept on declining. They just went down at the same rate as everybody else. So the message there is, taking amyloid away from the brain once the disease is established isn't working. And that's the brick wall that I was talking about. That's the lesson that we all, I think, when I say we, I mean the pharmaceutical world and the and researchers have to really take on board very quickly. And unfortunately, because we spent so much energy and put so much effort into this, it's catching those two groups, researchers and pharmaceutical world, by surprise. And it's been very disappointing, but it's all happened rather quickly because we only had the failure of Merck's drug, which I'll talk about in a minute, earlier this year. And solanezumab, which is an antibody, which is a Lilly drug, failed in November of last year. So, you know, we're right in the time frame of readjusting to this kind of critical new data. So where did the amyloid hypothesis come from? Well, I have to admit that I'm partly responsible for it, and so is Fiona Crawford at the Institute, because we were studying, as Steve said in the introduction, these rare early onset families. So I was looking at families that had the disease in their 50s, in their early 50s, and we found that mutations in the amyloid gene was responsible for early onset Alzheimer's in those families. And I think I was the senior author on a paper published in Nature, which for the first time used the word cause in the title, and it said mutations in this gene cause Alzheimer's disease. That was in 1991. It was a big step forward, and we thought, wow, this is going to be easy. This causes the disease, take amyloid away, and everything's going to be great. And it's, 25, 27 years later, it's been it hasn't been that easy. But one of the key messages why we kind of got confused is there was an assumption that amyloid would therefore cause all cases of Alzheimer's disease, and that genetic mutations in amyloid, we found out very quickly that genetic mutations in amyloid is not the reason why most people have the disease. It's absolutely not. These are very, very, very rare families. But what happened was the idea that amyloid causes the disease was extrapolated to all Alzheimer's. And that's still what we're living with today. And that's really the genesis of the amyloid cascade hypothesis. So let me show you an example, because it is quite striking when you see it. So these are two individuals, siblings. This person's unaffected, and this person was affected. And this is a DNA scan. And what you're looking at here is the same sequence between these two people and their same genes. And if you look at this area through here, there's nothing there or there, but there is here. These two changes, and these two are weaker. So these two is the same, are the same ones. So they have one chromosome that's similar. But this person has inherited another chromosome that has this two base pair change. So this is, you know, two letters out of tens of thousands in the DNA code. And that's what causes Alzheimer's disease. And it does it with 100% certainty in these families, but they're extremely rare. So I can promise you, we can take all of your blood in here today and do this analysis, and none of you will have these mutations. But we are all at risk for Alzheimer's disease. So this is not the usual cause of the disease. But it was very helpful because we made animal models, and this is something else we might talk about later on. Mice were produced, and the Roskam Institute was one of the first places in the world to get those mice that contain this, which, you know, the so-called Swedish mutation. And so we were able to try and cure those mice very early on. And at least 10 years ago now, we had multiple drugs that can stop the mice getting Alzheimer-like pathology. So, and one of those drugs actually went forward into clinical trials. So we and everybody else in the world use this mutation and the other mutations we found on a daily basis to try and find new treatments. The problem is that, or one aspect of that is, that this only really speaks to early onset Alzheimer's disease. So one of the questions we have is, are our mouse models really that good? Because these are just really models of early onset Alzheimer's disease. And should we be thinking about other models? Because the main driver for Alzheimer's for most of us has to do with aging. And that's not the sole driver here, obviously, otherwise we wouldn't get it so early. So this is a very important graph, and it really tells you something of what I've just said, but it puts it all together. So this is time. This is us, you know, aging down here. And I'll give you an idea. From here back to here is, you know, in the order of 15 years. So you're starting off down here, you may be, I don't know, 55 years old. So here you're 70, and then back up here you may be 80 on average, that kind of number. And what you have here is the CSF amyloid. So this purple thing here on the outside, that is central cerebrospinal fluid levels of amyloid. And what happens is, you can see it goes up. It goes up and then it reaches a plateau pretty much and goes on here. This is amyloid PET, so this is a positron emission tomography of amyloid as it accumulates in the brain. And that also goes up, and then it pretty much plateaus. And then we have CSF tau levels that go from normal up. But what I want to point out to you here is, this line here that I've put in, that's the line where people first start to see problems, first start to see cognitive problems. And they don't necessarily even come to the clinic then. They may not come to the clinic until another couple of years later. But you can see that by that point, the amyloid changes in the cerebrospinal fluid and in the brain are pretty much maxed out. And they've been, you know, quite high for some time. The tau is still changing a little bit. And then after that, this line represents what happens on MRI. So that's the brain shrinking. So you start to see that later. And then finally, down here, this is the actual clinical diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. There's mild cognitive impairment and there's full-blown dementia. So, you know, this is happening several years after all of these other things. So this is a chain of events. Now, how they're related exactly, we still don't clearly know. But this is a sort of observational. We can observe that the amyloid changes first and reaches a maximum in the brain. Then the tau changes and reaches a maximum. And then there's loss of neurons. And then we start to get the clinical symptoms. And in some estimates, in some families in particular, this can all start 25 years before there's any clinical problems at all. And so what I mentioned to you was, if we start trying to remove amyloid here, when dementia is established, you can see the amyloid is already completely full, you know, in the brain. It's kind of maxed out in the brain, and taking it away here just doesn't have an effect. It's not helpful. So the way the pharmaceutical companies are thinking about this now is they have put so much effort and energy into amyloid, and you know they have drugs that are relatively safe. Their theory is, well, why don't we just take it into the clinic earlier and earlier? So why don't we try and stop amyloid accumulating way back here? And a question of maybe if you get in the very early stages in MCI, maybe that'll be helpful, but maybe you have to go back even earlier. So that's kind of the way that they're going. And I'd like to talk about that a little bit because of the challenges that brings up. The challenges in terms of how we would instigate programs like that, if a drug was ever approved that could slow the disease, how would that work out in practice? How would we do that? How would we give it to people? How would we identify the people that should be taking it? What about the prospect of taking a drug for 10 or longer years that right now they have known side effects and you're normal? So okay, now in some ways we already have the model for that, right? We have the statins is a good model of that. But so far the drugs that we have that are anti-amyloid drugs are not as benign as statins. And then there's the cost. So some of the antibodies, and by the way, so because some of the drugs are they're antibodies, you have to have them infused. So there would be monthly infusions probably in normal people. So you'd have to go to infusion clinics on a monthly basis for, maybe starting in your 50s. So that would be an interesting challenge. And so, these are things that we can talk about at the end maybe, but the idea that's the solution to the disease is, I don't think it is. The other issue, and this is the thing that I worry most about, is what about the people that kind of already have the disease? The 5.5 million people that I talked about in this country, another 50 in total probably worldwide. What about those? If we just focus on anti-amyloid treatments, we are basically pushing the boat out on those folks. Plus, by the time these drugs get into the clinic, there'll be another whole cohort of people that have moved up and are in this range now. So you can, I think, get a sense of the urgency here and the problem here that the failure of those trials has kind of brought up. So let me talk to you a little bit about another way. I mentioned antibodies already. I'll go back to that in a second. But let me talk to you about another way of stopping amyloid accumulating, which has been tried. And so the failure earlier this year was actually a so-called BACE inhibitor. BACE stands for beta site APP, and APP stands for amyloid precursor protein cleaving enzyme. Basically what happens is the body, the neurons, makes this very long structure called APP, and it gets cut by these enzymes, represented here as scissors, gets cut in two places. The one outside of the cell is called BACE. The one that cuts inside the membrane is called gamma secretase. And the idea is very simple. If you can inhibit those enzymes, then by definition, you can't make amyloid. If you can't make amyloid, by definition, in the amyloid cascade hypothesis, you can't make Alzheimer's. So we and others have worked on BACE inhibitors for a long time. It was very, very, we worked on developing them, our own ones. It's a very, very difficult target. But finally, the pharmaceutical world has managed to do that. And the one that just failed was verubecestat. And verubecestat was in a phase 3 trial, and that was actually stopped. It didn't get to the end. They did what's called a futility analysis, and they halfway through, and they realized that there was no way that the drug could ever be shown to be helpful because there was really no difference between placebo and treated groups. We haven't actually seen those data yet, but so Merck pulled the drug. Now, they're gonna carry on with this, as I suggested they would, and most companies will do this, in earlier and earlier stage disease. They're probably gonna start with MCI or even prodromal Alzheimer's. And there are a number of other BACE inhibitors out there, but probably we're gonna find the same thing, that once you have established disease, they don't work. And probably the drug companies are going to do the same thing. They're just going to move earlier and earlier. And then here's the antibodies. So solanezumab was the big failure from Lilly. Bapineuzumab was another drug that was one of the first ones out there. That failed as well. Lilly thinks they've spent on their Alzheimer program, since they instituted their Alzheimer program, according to Eric Siemens, they think they spent $27 billion. So it isn't that anybody's not trying. But you know, that's the sort of thing somewhere down the line, you know, that's tough for pharmaceutical companies to keep going on things that are not working. And actually, they deserve a lot more credit than they get, because many investors a long time ago, you know, taking the position, why are we wasting our time on amyloid and Alzheimer's? Why are we wasting our time on Alzheimer's? And I guess the answer to that is it's this huge market, if there's any drug of, you know, of any success at all. But that's a big commitment and a big loss. And my guess is that Lilly, my best is that Pfizer and some of these other companies have the same. Now, the compound out there that's looking most promising is aducanumab, Biogen's drug, which looks like, again, only in the early stages, it looks like if you get people in the MCI stage, you can actually get the amyloid out of the brain, and then there's a little clinical signal that they actually do a little bit better. But again, not in established Alzheimer's disease. So, you know, how it's interesting too that even despite the $27 billion from one company alone, still not clear how these things work. Still a lot of debate over that, and I could get into that in a lot of detail, but I won't. But one of the things that does come up is I just came back from what's called the ADPD meeting, Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease meeting in Europe. And it was interesting to hear some of the lead scientists there saying, well, look, you know, wrong patients, meaning they got mild to moderate patients, they should have had earlier ones, wrong dose of the drug, you know, wrong formulation, you know, what do you expect? But I actually think that's a little bit of an unfair criticism, because these are very experienced, professional, you know, top range companies that are involved in these studies. That's the best we could do, and the best we can do didn't work. So you can always keep coming back and saying, well, you know, the amyloid story would have worked if only we'd done this and only we'd done that. But how much money do we have to spend to before we decide? Even if it can work, it's clearly not working very well, and it's not that much of a, you know, it's not clearly not an easy target. But one of the things that comes up in all of those discussions is, well, you don't know how the drug's working, so, you know, why do you expect it to work? But so it's interesting that one of the ways that the antibodies work is they go into the brain and they stick on those deposits of amyloid that I showed you, and they get the inflammatory cells in the brain very upset, and the inflammatory cells come along and engulf some of the amyloid. That's the theory. Another idea is that there's direct sort of, they break up the big clumps, and then the amyloid, some, you know, dissolves and goes back into solution. Another idea is the so-called peripheral sink idea, where the amyloid is broke, it crosses the blood-brain barrier and gets sucked up in the periphery by very high levels of amyloid. And another idea is that you break down, you know, these so-called toxic oligomers. And I may talk about that a little bit later. So I think I've mentioned most of this, but just to outline one area here. So one of the ways that the drug companies are going is looking at so-called PET-positive individuals. So these are normal folks that have amyloid in their brain, and if you look at PET level, using a PET marker, you can see the amyloid in their brain. I have a picture of it later on. And so they'd be taken, and there's so-called secondary prevention trials. So you're giving the drugs to people that don't have any cognitive problems, they don't have any disease, but on scan they show, and the, you know, the scan is done by for some of the studies that we do in the clinic, it can be done in town here. It's done fairly routinely. It's not used, you know, clinically. It's not used as a diagnosis. It's only used in clinical trials at the moment. But PET positive trials is a way to go. But one of the things I think about too is this, that in order to get FDA approval that early intervention with an anti-amyloid treatment could delay the onset and slow the disease in late onset disease, you'd have to start the treatment maybe 10 years before you expect people to get the disease. And only a proportion are going to get it. This is a clinical trial now. So you may have to have thousands and thousands of people, and it's going to take a long, long time to demonstrate to the FDA that it's going to work. So these are all the kind of obstacles that is another other reasons, I think, why we should be shifting focus. So let me try and get around to, so I think I've been through that. So let me try and get around to, I've been through that too, some other areas that I think we should focus on. So let's go back and talk about tau for a little bit, because at least tau pathology is actually occurring and continues to occur as the cognitive decline occurs. So if you look at the relationship between amyloid and cognitive decline, there just isn't a relationship for the reasons I told you. But if you look at tau and those tau markers, either in the brain or in the blood, the more tau you get in the brain, the worse you are cognitively. So it seems like intervening there might be a way to go. And so some of the things that's happening, that the same kind of ideas with amyloid are coming up with tau. So there are already antibodies to tau that are being developed and tested. So that might be helpful. We're a little bit further down the track, and certainly people have established disease and cognitively impaired when they have a tau accumulation. So that might be a bit more hopeful. But at the Roskam Institute, we've certainly looked at tau, but we've looked at all of these other things too, and other people around the world are now starting to do that. I don't think we're doing it quickly enough, and I don't think we're transferring resources to these things quickly enough, but these are other possibilities. We've looked at inflammation for a long time. I can't remember when I had the first paper on inflammation and Alzheimer's disease, but it's back in the 80s. And certainly inflammation plays a key role. The issue about inflammation might come up in question time, but it's about timing, because a certain amount of inflammation is helpful in Alzheimer's disease, it looks that way, but then chronic inflammation, which is what you're getting the disease, is not helpful and is certainly destructive. Immunity is something I'm going to touch on as well, I think. I think there's an argument to be made that the body does not respond to amyloid in the way it responds to other aberrant proteins. So because it's host, because we have amyloid from before birth, our body regards it as host, so it doesn't attack it. So even though there are cells that can recognize amyloid, they don't send up any signal, because we make it ourselves. If you attack your own proteins, you've got autoimmune disease. However, when it starts to change shape and forms those amyloid clumps, some little parts of which get into the periphery, you would think that the body would look at that and say, wait, this is new. We haven't seen this before. We should make antibodies. But it doesn't. And there's an argument that, very similar to what happens in cancer, that there is suppression of an immune response, a full-blown immune response. So we and others for a while now have been looking at ways of letting that immune response free so that it can actually attack amyloid. Energy metabolism. So there's very strong data suggesting that the brain with Alzheimer's disease doesn't metabolize energy, doesn't use glucose, for instance, in the same way as a non-Alzheimer brain. And that is something that we and others are looking at. Vascular aspects we've looked at for a long time. I could talk about that for a long time, but I won't. But bottom line is, if you have a little bit of Alzheimer's disease and a little bit of vascular disease, that's when you start to bring out a lot of the cognitive problems. So going after vascular problems and keeping those under control is very critical. And then ApoE, although none of you are at risk for the mutation I showed you earlier, we're all at risk for a variation in the gene called ApoE. ApoE comes in three varieties. Two, three, and four are the common ones. And three and four are the real common ones. Most ApoE comes in the E3 version, but the E4 version puts us more at risk for Alzheimer's disease. It's very well documented. And so that's a potential target too. Even though most of the research world thinks that the way ApoE works is through amyloid, and so altering ApoE won't have much effect because we've talked about amyloid not being a great target, I think there's other data suggesting that this is a player that influences the disease all the way through. So we're looking at that at the Institute as well. So back to those markers. So here's an amyloid scan showing amyloid accumulating in that area that I talked to you about, the hippocampus. But here's tau PET as well. And so So in the same way that there'll be, you know, amyloid positive folks recruited in to studies, I am anticipating that very soon we'll be seeing this too, where people that have tau positive will be coming into studies. That'll be a step forward because they will already have established disease. So that's an important step in the right direction. Problem with tau is the same sort of problem with amyloid, and I haven't got into this much with amyloid, but tau, like amyloid, comes in a myriad of forms, and there's big debate about which is the best form to go after, just as there was with amyloid. So some of the antibodies, for instance, go after what are called monomers, just single molecules of amyloid, whereas others go after these complex forms and go after plaque. So aducanumab, the Biogen drug, goes after plaque itself, whereas solanezumab, you know, went after single monomeric form. And so that's another kind of debate in our world, trying to figure out which is the right one to go after. And we're going to have the same problem with tau, because tau comes in many forms. It firstly starts off like this, then it forms a dimer, then it forms what are called oligomers, and these things are soluble, then it forms paired helical filaments, and then it's called neurofibrillary tangles. So which is the right one to go after? It's going to take us a while to figure that out. And different companies will go after different forms. So, but the pros then are, as I mentioned, that it much better correlates with cognitive problems. It's a neuronal target. It's actually the neurons. The amyloid is outside of the neurons. So this is something inside the neurons. So you'd think if your car's broken down, better to try and fix something inside the car than something outside of it. And, you know, there's an argument for that. But there's still this question, will it work in established disease? We're not sure. So other strategies for the prevention, slowing, and cure of Alzheimer's disease. Well, we may end up in the same way as the HIV AIDS community did with treatments. We may end up with combination therapies. I can see a day when, you know, if folks are in the relatively early stages of the disease, they would have maybe some amyloid treatment, but maybe some anti-tau treatment, and then other treatments, including some from the list that I've just talked about. And I guess some of the problem there is when, you know, timing's going to be critical, because this disease clearly changes over the time. One of the things that's really interesting, just going back to what I said earlier about, you know, amyloid later, taking the amyloid out later, not having an effect. So the disease kind of gets a mind of its own, in a sense. There are mechanisms that occur within the disease that just keep going, you know, in the absence of amyloid. Those are the mechanisms that we really need to tease out and understand, because that's the way we're going to slow the disease once it's established. And then down the bottom here, I've put this in: drugs plus lifestyle plus medical management of risk factors. And I'm going to talk about those things right now, because I guess there's this idea that we're all kind of waiting for this magic pill to take, maybe. But I think also we all understand that, as with most diseases, cancer is a good example, oftentimes lifestyle choices have a big impact on our risk. And that absolutely the same is true for Alzheimer's disease. So we should perhaps be thinking, you know, more broadly about not just drugs, but about lifestyle changes as well. And then finally, the combination of those two. So I'm just going to branch off for a second here to talk about the clinical trial that is just being completed in Europe and we're currently analyzing. And I want to say something very general about this before I get into the details. Firstly, I think it's absolutely remarkable that a small institute like the Ross Kemp Institute had got a drug all the way through to phase 3 clinical trials. If you want to know who the other people are that have got drugs that far, you show a list of some of them early on. It's these multi-billion dollar companies. And I can't say enough about, you know, Bob Roskamp and his family and what they've done to make that possible, because what they did was a rather amazing thing. They, you know, set up a standalone biomedical research center that can change direction very quickly. That's entrepreneurial, that can spin off for-profits, that can partner with for-profits, but can move very quickly in a way that universities frequently can't. and pharma frequently can't. So because of that, not only did we get the Alzheimer's mice early and we're trying drugs early, we also got a drug out there all the way through to phase three. You can count on one hand the other groups in the world that have done that that are not big pharma. So I think we have a very special, obviously I have a vested interest because I work there, but even if I didn't, we have a very special place up the road here called the Roskam Institute that really has done what I've just said, really has got a drug all the way through. So we're going to be looking at the results of that pretty soon. And I put this up here just to kind of confuse everybody and for you to say not more molecular biology. No, but it's not to explain anything. It's just to say that the way that drug works is in several modes. So down here we have amyloid, down here we have inflammation, over here we have tau, and here we have a direct effect on memory. So the way this thing works at the molecular level is it hits several targets. It doesn't just focus on amyloid. And whether that drug works or not, this kind of approach, which we've pioneered for a long time, I think is a very valuable approach. It instead of just going after one molecule, one thing, it tries to dampen down the whole environment in the brain. So I'm very excited about pursuing this route. Okay, so a lot of depressing facts, figures, brick walls. Let me try and talk about another side, and certainly of how I think about Alzheimer's disease. And that is that there are lifestyle choices that we can make that absolutely change our risk for the disease. And just in contrast to the drugs that we do have right now, things like Aricept and Exelon, the effects of some of these lifestyle choices way outweigh the effects you see with drugs. And so I'm not saying, obviously not saying we shouldn't be chasing after the drugs, that's what I do every day. But this is important information, I think, and is not sort of generally understood. I mean, we understand that if we want to reduce our risk for cardiac disease, we should be taking walks and so on, but it's not generally in the general population that people understand. If you want to reduce the risk for Alzheimer's disease, you should be taking walks. And so this is a growing body of data that we and others have compiled, and we actually began a program trying to institute this through the clinic to get people to understand that there's a lot you can do. So the areas you can work on are brain activity, and talk about that a little bit, physical activity, diet, and control of medical conditions. And I'm just going to have, I think I've got one slide on each one. So this is the case of the London taxi drivers. This sounds like a Sherlock Holmes movie, doesn't it? But actually what it is what they did was that part of the brain that I mentioned earlier, the part of the brain in the temporal lobe that's responsible for memory and new memory and using new memory, the hippocampus. What they did is they measured the volume of that in London taxi drivers. And before iPhones came along and you could just use GPS to get everywhere, London taxi drivers had to take a test, and it was called the knowledge. And the knowledge essentially was being able to reproduce in your head a map of London. So somebody would say, take me to Bond Street, or I'm going to get off at Marlborough Station, take me to the Ritz, or whatever. And you had to be able to figure out how to get there in your head. And you had to figure out the quickest route. And so taxi drivers would learn all of this. They would learn not only a map of London, but where the roadworks were and the quickest ways, which streets were one way and so on. And you used to see them driving around London on these little mopeds with a map in front of them, very dangerous, but that's what they did until they learned the knowledge. And they measured the size of the hippocampus in taxi drivers, the physical size of it, compared to ordinary folks that didn't have to do that for a living. And they're bigger. It's bigger in the taxi drivers. And they followed it up too. They looked at people learning the knowledge, and you can see their hippocampi growing. And then you looked at people who stopped being taxi drivers or started to use GPS, and you can see it fading. So it's like a muscle in that the more you use the brain, the bigger it physically bigger it gets.
which is quite remarkable. We don't really think about that, but it's absolutely the case. And there's been a lot of other studies done the same way. And I think I have one here. Yeah, so this is another exercise. These are both exercises, I'm sorry. So this is a study done in rats. And this is part of the rat brain, and it's stained, that the yellow and orange here is stained for a growth factor that makes neurons grow. It stimulates neuronal growth. And this rat has been exercised, and this one hasn't. And this is absolutely true of humans too. You can put us on a treadmill, and you can take blood before and after we use the treadmill, and if we use it in a certain way for a certain time, you can measure this brain-derived growth factor in the blood. So there's very good data, and this is the next piece I wanted to show you, that if you walk, and this was the effect of walking a certain number of blocks in New York, these were the parts of the brain that actually physically grew. And they grow because of this growth factor, the growth factor that's released when we exercise. There's a lot of data like this. So I can't emphasize the importance of physical exercise enough. It really has an effect on the side of our brains. We can talk about why that is. It may be counterintuitive to us, but it could well be, if you roll the clock back a few thousand years or a few tens of thousands, that, you know, remembering where the tiger was correlates very much with how fast you can run. And so, you know, you're running away from it and your brain is making BDNF and your cells are growing, and guess what? I'm not going back there again. I know what, you know, where that problem is. So whatever the reason, this is true and very important, I think. This is another thing that really strikes me. And these are individuals that already received a diagnosis of mild cognitive impairment. So they already were in the early stage of the disease, got a lot of amyloid in their brains, starting to have those tau changes. And these are so-called survival curves. So basically, you know, the further you go down here, the more chance there is that you will have converted to Alzheimer's disease. And this is time scale. So if we look at the 50% line here, say, you know, once you have a diagnosis of Alzheimer's, you have a full-blown conversion. 50% of the people, if you have 100 people that have MCI, 8 years in, 50% of them will have Alzheimer's disease. They will have converted to Alzheimer's. Those were people on a normal diet. But these people were on a Mediterranean diet. And you can see that, you know, at 8 years, there's probably only about 25% that had got the disease. So cutting your risk in half by changing to a Mediterranean diet, you're actually cutting your risk of converting to Alzheimer's disease once you have established MCI by 50%. The numbers are very similar to this if you go back and look at individuals at risk for the disease but don't even have MCI. And then finally, just a quick list of all the medical risk factors that independently increase their risk for Alzheimer's disease. So for instance, uncontrolled atrial fibrillation is very bad for your risk of Alzheimer's disease. And if you've had a stroke, if there's some kind of indication that you've had a small vascular event already, it can increase your risk by 4 times. These are huge numbers. So, but it's very easy to control atrial fibrillation. I mean, you just need to be really aggressive about it. Your physicians need to be really aggressive about getting that under control. But it has a big risk. There's a lot of other things down here. Late life diabetes, and particularly if it's undiagnosed or poorly controlled diabetes, very bad news for increasing the risk for Alzheimer's disease. The reason I put this list up is not to scare people, it's to do the complete opposite. Everything on this list pretty much can be fixed. It just needs aggressive intervention by GP and specialist. And then here's one down here, which is midlife obesity. So if you have a BMI over 30, you increase your risk. Okay, so in the last couple of minutes, I'm just going to make a small plug for the Ross Kemp Institute Clinic. We do memory screening, free memory screening, and really, this let me broaden the plug a little bit. Actually, everything I've told you today about the clinical trials, both our own and everybody else's, really has to do with volunteers that come from the community. Without people coming forward into clinical trials, I couldn't have, this would have been a very short discussion, wouldn't it, today? So it's very important, I think, that the Ross Kemp Institute has good relationships with the community and encourages people to come through into new clinical trials. We learn a lot that way, and Lois and Sandra are over there. If you have interest in getting involved with clinical trials, MCI, full-blown Alzheimer's disease trials, then please speak to them afterwards. If I knew somebody that had the disease, I would very much recommend that they get involved with clinical trials somewhere, because I think it's helpful and important to be. The other thing, of course, is that it's very important to get the diagnosis right. There's an awful lot of causes of memory loss and memory disorder, and they're not all Alzheimer's disease. Many of them are treatable. Many, many, many of them are completely treatable. So it's very important, if there's memory loss, to come and have a full-blown assessment. Okay, I think, and that's just what we do, comprehensive history examination, neurological neuropsych examination, radiology. We have this interdisciplinary group. It's a very expert, very experienced group of folks that work there, very dedicated. So, in conclusion, we desperately need to broaden our focus away from just amyloid onto many other potential ways to treat Alzheimer's disease. I think the funding agencies and other advocates really need to grasp the nettle here and drive down these alternative roads. Like anything else, it takes a long time for ideas to be laid to rest. But I think the message right now is it's anti-amyloid treatments just not working in established disease. Probably fine to pursue them in early stage disease, but we really need to put a lot of energy elsewhere. One of the fantastic things about the Institute is we can change directions so quickly. So not only have we been working on these things for a long time, our pivot to charge harder down some of these roads will be much, much faster than many other places, both commercial and non-commercial. And then finally, don't despair, because there's an awful lot you can do today to reduce your risk by lifestyle changes. And that's the Ross Kemp team, or some of them at least. And sorry about the backing up, but they do most of the work. So thank you very much indeed for your attention, and I'll take some questions if there's time. Thank you. So I'm sure that the Mediterranean diet isn't the best diet in the world to prevent Alzheimer's disease. It's just the one that's been tested the most. And in answer to your question, people have looked at different aspects of it. So lipids, for instance, we know. Omega-3 lipids versus omega-6 lipids. Clearly, that's very important. So we understand it at that level, and certain other vitamins, of course, in that diet, low levels of saturated fat, relatively low levels of, or very low levels of processed carbohydrates and sugars. So we understand some of it, but I agree with you. Drilling down to the next level is really important, and that needs to happen. Some of that work's going on already, yes. I'm not sure that's the case, but what will happen is, generally speaking, what happens in these studies is you take samples, like we did in Europe. You take samples and you store them, and then you come back later when you have some idea of what's going on. But what would certainly have been done is they'd have been screened for B12 deficiencies and other obvious causes of cognitive loss, yeah. But again, back to taking part in clinical studies, taking part, giving blood samples, giving CSF samples, these are kind of critical things, and the field really wouldn't be where it was if people didn't do that. That's the question. I have the same question. Well, my biggest question is, how do they get away with it? That people do things like that, and I'm sorry that they do it. It's just wrong, actually. Yes.
Is it familial?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, there's a common genetic variant that we all have, or common genetic variants, some one of which can put us at risk. So what you tend to see, and that's inherited in also a dominant fashion, which means that 50% of everybody's offspring will inherit it. And fortunately, it's rarer. It only occurs 15% of the time compared to 85% of the AE3 form. But you do see it clustering in families, absolutely. And it's sometimes it's that. There are a lot of other genes as well that can impact the disease. So yeah, it's often familial. But you know, but the biggest risk factor which outweighs familiarity is age, which we're all at risk for. Yeah, I suspect that's another way of asking, you know, can I get somebody else to take my body to the gym and get them to work it out? I don't think so. I don't think so. Certainly now there isn't. Yeah, there isn't now. Yes. So B12, low B12 on its own can give you dementia. Chronic low B12 levels on its own can give you dementia. And so I'm sure when you all go and get your annual checkups, you look very carefully at that B12 number and make sure that your GPs keep you, you know, well. Absolutely. I think that the point is this, that using your brain is really important. It's interesting though. You don't have to be, you know, studying, getting a PhD somewhere. But what you do, because especially social interaction seems to be really important. It's very interesting that that's the case. But a lot of studies have shown that, you know, continued frequent social interaction is very important for lowering the risk for Alzheimer's disease. But also in the context of reading and puzzles and, you know, games in general, very, very important. So, yeah, in general, try and stimulate your mind as much as you can. And I think people usually say, well, you know, what do you have to do? I think it's a little bit like the gym. If it doesn't hurt a little bit, it's probably not working. So I think that's probably true. There's a huge area of research that we're talking about now. And what people have found is that it doesn't seem to be one thing. People are looking for this like magic crossover thing to do. So you stimulate in your brain, you know, on language side, and it starts to work on the calculation side. It doesn't seem to work quite like that. There's many, many things that can protect you. But I think you have to work a little bit hard. You know, sitting in front of the TV, I don't think that's doing it. So,
where does
Lewy body disease
fit into the spectrum?
Lewy body disease, yeah. So Lewy body disease is very similar in some ways to tau pathology and to amyloid pathology. It's a misfolded protein disease. It's actually caused by alpha-synuclein, which is another protein, and it's responsible when those things occur, particularly when they occur in the basal ganglia, you get Parkinson's disease. When they occur in the cortex, it's often called Lewy body disease, and Lewy body disease is another cause of dementia, separate from Alzheimer's disease, with different consequences. So yeah, another reason, all dementia is absolutely not Alzheimer's disease. We don't yet have treatments for Lewy body disease, but other groups are working on that too. Yeah. So.
You mentioned B12. What other vitamins that you could recommend and help to maybe prevent a little bit of Alzheimer's?
What's generally recommended is just vitamins within the normal range. B12 kind of stands out on its own as being able to exclusively cause dementia. There aren't many, maybe B2, but there aren't many others that stick on B6, but there aren't many others. The B vitamins and B12, there aren't many others that fit that. Vitamin C deficiency doesn't cause it, for instance. E and D deficiencies don't, although there's some story about vitamin D. So we're still, but basically if you are you know, well within range. I don't think you have to take huge doses of any of these things. Again, a lot of that comes down to a good, well-balanced diet and, you know, so on. Okay, maybe one more question, if there is any, or if not, yes. Well, so what hasn't happened with those programs is it hasn't been proven that if you intervene with those programs specifically, you can lower your risk for the disease. What is shown is a plethora of research that if you use your brains generally, for instance, if you have higher, you know, educational background, for instance, then your risk goes down. I think, what's it called, Lumosity got dinged because they were making claims that, you know, it could potentially lower your risk for AD, and that hasn't been proven. But in general, those sorts of programs should be helpful. Yeah. Okay, thank you so much for your attention.